Thank you very much for having me. A special thanks to the University of Indianapolis, UIndy, as I understand is the right way to refer to it. And if you're like me, the best part, one of the best parts about attending conferences away from your home university or college is the opportunity to meet and converse, have fellowship with colleagues from around the world, around the United States in this instance. And that's already been true with me, because I haven't met many of you before, but now I have had the distinct pleasure of meeting my co-presenter, John Hart, and as well as obviously Joe Creech and a few others, and so I really appreciate the opportunity to be here. I'm going to spend my brief time basically putting in context some of the key issues that I think affect us all as we navigate these shoals of legal restrictions that are currently, at least in the news. But the takeaway, if you will, should be several things. One is, and I'm going to talk about it at the end, is making sure that the structures and the people and the organization is in place to keep the institutional eye on the mission. And that can be a challenge in some respects. In other respects, you're going to hear me say it's just a matter of determination and hard work. The other thing that I want to have as a takeaway is that as senior administrators, we all should be able to discuss intelligently with our neighbors, with our non-education colleagues. We ought to be able to discuss intelligently this notion of religious liberty in this country, what it means, what it doesn't mean, and to understand its complexity. And so one of my goals is not to simplify this, as might be the case on one of the popular talk shows on TV or radio, but rather to complexify it, because it's not, in my mind, an especially simple subject, although we will be able to discuss what I think might be some of the more straightforward answers to it when I'm done. I'm in an interesting position to do this, because I wear three hats, really. I wear the hat of a lawyer and a law professor. I wear the hat as president of a Catholic Jesuit Marymount University in Los Angeles, LMU. And I wear the hat as a non-Catholic and obviously non-Jesuit. I'm Presbyterian. And I'm somewhat of a, I have some friends here, I'm somewhat of an experiment, perhaps. But I feel that it's important for me to emphasize this because I think it gives me a unique perspective from which to discuss advancing the distinctly Catholic, Jesuit, and Marymount traditions and mission at LMU. And again, we'll get to that in a moment. So the way that I'm going to put this in context is to first is, and it's this for the historians and the, well, maybe for all of you, but especially the historians and the other general counsel or lawyers in the room, I apologize. But I want everybody sort of starting on ground zero. I'm going to contextualize it by just briefly referring to the two religion clauses. And then I want to talk about two major cases that set the Supreme Court cases that sort of set the ground work or lay the framework, I should say. And that's the case, the Smith case and from 1990, and then just last term's Hosanna Tabor case. And then I want to discuss all of that as sort of using those as a case study. I want to look specifically at the recent HHS requirement for contraception coverage and by employers, and that's going to be the way that I want to focus in on this whole notion of religious liberty. So first, I don't have to remind you that the very first restrictions on governmental action that were included in the First Amendment were the restrictions relating to the establishment of religion and the free exercise of religion. And they're written in a remember, they're not written like as you have these freedoms. It is written, the First Amendment, as all most of the rights in the Constitution, are written as restrictions on governmental action. So your freedom is coterminate or is equivalent to the degree to which governmental conduct is restricted from impinging upon whatever the activity or whatever the scope of its coverage is. And so the First Amendment says Congress shall not enact any law respecting the establishment of an religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. Those are the two clauses. So Congress can't act in a way to establish a religion. Congress cannot act in a way to prohibit its free exercise. And if you know your constitutional history, even though it was written with the word Congress as the subject, through the incorporation doctrine starting back in the Earl Warren Court of the 50s and the 60s and the 70s, it is now included. You should read it. It's not, it doesn't Congress, but any level of government. So agencies at the federal level, state governments, local levels, municipalities, mosquito abatement districts, any level of government may not act in a way to establish religion or to restrict the free exercise thereof. Those two clauses are sometimes in tension with one another. And we'll see how that works with the exemptions that Congress writes and sometimes appear in other statutes for religious activities or religious organizations. And just bear in mind that sometimes when Congress tries to accommodate religion and religious practices by giving a special exemption to those practices, the government will be sued or will be accused of establishing religion, giving religion an unfair advantage. When they don't act to give that exemption and laws therefore have an impact on religious practices, they will get sued for not accommodating, for prohibiting the free exercise. And so it's important to understand at the outset that this is not a simple area for a lawmaker. It's not a simple area for a lawmaker. And that tension, which I think is resolvable, but I'm going to be as objective as I know how to be. And when I'm not, I will tell you what my bias is so you can discount for it. I think that there is a real tension that we're seeing now being played out at both the national stage and at the local stages with respect to the proper role of government in this area. And two cases are going to illustrate that, I think, real clearly. The first one is the Employment Division, Department of Human Resources of Oregon versus Smith in 1990. Fascinating case. Fascinating in a lot of ways, but particularly because it was written, the majority opinion was written by Justice Scalia and joined by the four conservative, in quotes, members of the Supreme Court. The only two members of the court that are still on the, that were in the Smith case, that are still on the court today are Justices Scalia and Justice Kennedy. But so in this case involved first a criminal statute in the state of Oregon. And that criminal statute said you can't possess or use peyote. Pretty basic. It was just listed as one of the scheduled controlled substances that the state of Oregon criminalized, the possession of, or use of which Oregon criminalized. Two members of the Native American church, as part of their sacrament, religious ceremony, it was sacramental use of peyote, as was the custom, used peyote, and they ironically or not, they held jobs at a drug rehabilitation center. The drug rehabilitation center found out about the fact that during a religious ceremony they used this controlled substance, and they fired them for misconduct. They went and applied for unemployment insurance. Oregon said, like most states, you're not entitled to unemployment insurance if the reason for your discharge was misconduct. And here, you engage in misconduct. Their defense was, what are you talking about? This is a core part of our religious ceremony. And they said, tough. It goes all the way to the Supreme Court. And the court decides 5-4 that tough luck to the two Native Americans.